Good afternoon, and welcome to our weekly Tuesday webinar. I'm Yomika Bennett, Executive Director of the New York Charter School Association. I'm joined today by Susie Carello, Executive Director of the SUNY Charter Schools Institute, David Frank, Executive Director of the Charter Schools Office at NYSED, Anjali Matos, Executive Director, Policy and Operations at New York City Department of Education, Aaron Cochran, Managing Director in the same office, and Laura Hazley, Senior Director, Charter Authorizing and Accountability at New York City DOE, and Corey Callahan from the New York City Charter Center. Today, again, we'll follow our usual format. I'll share a few updates. We'll hear updates from David, Susie, and Lori, field some outstanding questions, and then take questions from the Q&A before turning over to New York City DOE questions. A few scheduling and housekeeping notes. Join us, please, this Thursday at 4 p.m. when we will host Mackie Raymond and her team from Credo, along with the state's authorizers, to discuss the recent Credo report on charter activities during the first month of the COVID crisis. I'm happy to announce that also due to the overwhelming demand, Google for Education was able to increase the participation limit for the distance learning workshop on August 17th. Again, I'll repeat that because I know we had a lot of inquiries on this. The Google for Education workshop is the participant limit has been increased. The workshop is August 17th. Registration has been reopened. If you previously tried to register and got an overcapacity notification, please go back and register using the link in the chat. The workshop will be August 17th from 1 to 5 p.m. Schools are encouraged to send academic and operations or technology leaders. A recording will also be made available. To support schools as they prepare for the upcoming school year, InnoVare has launched a back-to-school playbook, combining some of the best resources into an easy-to-use and downloadable tool. This playbook is packed with best practices collected from some of the most reputable organizations in the education ecosystem to help ensure a safe, equitable, and confident start of the new year. To assist you in navigating this tool and to answer any questions that you may have, New York Charter School Association will be hosting a deep dive webinar on Thursday, August 20th at 4 p.m., featuring A.J. DeLeon and Nick Freeman from InnoVare. Now, turning to the updates, as a reminder, ESSER fund applications are due on August 15th. These federal funds were allocated as part of the CARES Act, which was passed in March, and both district and charter schools that have previously received Title I funding are eligible to receive them. We strongly urge all schools to apply. On August 5th, Governor Cuomo signed an executive order which extends the suspension of the in-person public meeting requirement of the open meetings law until September 4th, 2020. So I'll say that again, the open meetings law requirement has been extended, waiver has been extended until September 4th, 2020. In addition, you're all aware, I'm sure, of the governor held a conference call last Friday where he made the formal announcement that all schools in the state are authorized to open based on the low-level rates of virus transmission for each region. He reiterated, however, that how schools open is up to each district, and in this case, right, charter schools. The big headline from his announcement is that in order to address the concerns from parents and school staff about the safety of reopening, each district, and again in this case charter schools, should specifically post three aspects of their reopening plan on their website. One, distance learning plans, including addressing equity issues. Two, contact tracing plan. And three, student and staff testing plan. What happens when someone tests positive? How staff students can get testing? In addition, schools must hold at least three parent information sessions and one teacher staff information session. The additions to the website and these sessions must be completed by August 21st. With all that said, now we'll turn to David, Susie, and Lori. Welcome. We'd love to hear your updates as well as your thoughts on guidance and on the governor's announcements. We'll start with you, Susie. Welcome, because you're the first on my screen. You're here, the first one. Welcome, and do you have any updates?
Well, I wanted to start off with my deepest condolences to every one of you that was about to take off to Hawaii because it is now banned travel for us New Yorkers. So happy that you're all here with us. We looked at the governor's 3 to 5 public parent and teacher sessions by August 21st. I think some of you may actually have already started with some of your teachers. Shout out to Buffalo Creek, who's opening up this year, who tweeted out a pic this morning of a properly social distanced PD going on. So I'm going to assume that they have had conversations with those teachers because they are there for professional development. I think you want to do a few things. One is follow the governor's guidance. Two is there's a difference or distinction we see between having held some meetings with parents and others, parents and staff, prior to actually finalizing your plans. And then we think the governor's intention was to make sure that you socialized those plans, had opportunities for parents and teachers to ask more questions, and for you to repeat again, just like the governor's taught us all, right? 7 times, say it 7 times in 7 different ways, and then maybe people will start to internalize it. So we ask that you do that and keep track of those things. And you may want to, if you're having a Zoom format, take the opportunity to do what the association does, which is record it and stick it on your website for others. And Yumika already addressed the open meetings law, so that's great. Our renewal calls are happening with all of our schools that on top of everything else are playing along for renewal this year, so thank you. The team says they're really energized to hear all about your plans. And speaking of that, we have gotten in so many of your plans to us for reopening. They aren't due until this Friday, but we look forward to receiving them. I just also wanted to note that on Thursday, the fabulous Jeff Wasbis, the Institute's Executive Deputy for Accountability, is going to be joining the other authorizers and the Credo team for that webinar. So I will send a pizza to the person who asks Jeff the best stumper question on the webinar. He didn't know I was going to say that. So, lastly, we had a question from one of the schools about the ability or the authority of schools to require COVID tests for all students when they come. And the lawyers took a deep dive at the Institute, thank you, Carrie and Ralph, about this, and came to the conclusion that being the entities that we are as charter schools, we don't really have the authority. You don't really have the authority to require that at this point. And of course, then there are a number of other questions that kind of lead up to that, like who's going to pay for them, et cetera. But what is difficult to do is actually to deny a child. You can't deny a child an opportunity to come into the school if they have not had a COVID test. And so we're happy to talk about that a little bit more. If there are more questions about it, or if you have individual thoughts about that, please feel free to reach out to me or Ralph or Carrie, and we'll help you walk you through what the options are. So I think that's mine.
All right, great. Thank you, Susie. David, do you have an update for us?
Thanks, Yumika. It's good to be back here again. Wouldn't be Tuesday without these calls. We're very excited that the New York State Board of Regents appointed a new interim commissioner today, and someone who we're all very familiar with, Dr. Betty Rosa, who is currently serving as the chancellor. So it's an interesting turn of events, and we will continue to do our work in coordination with the Board of Regents. But for those of you in New York City, but across the state who know Dr. Rosa, you're very familiar with her stance towards charter schools. And she's just a proponent of high quality education for all kids. And certainly she's been very vocal about that on the Board of Regents, and now she will be more involved on the day-to-day work that we're doing through my office, which I certainly do welcome. So that was some news for today. We are very grateful for all the schools who submitted their reopening plans, and it was fantastic to read about them I loved reading the plans that really were very student focused, and you know, I read about the work happening across the state. My friend Luca from Buffalo, in particular, and his mom, I was very glad to read about their plans and seeing these very student focused plans that people have for the fall. I would keep in mind that although the governor's new requirements to consult parents and staff was announced last week, I'm very heartened to know that our charter schools across the state, whether your Board of Regents authorized SUNY or DOE or Buffalo authorized, you've already been doing this work. And it really was evident in your plan. So I really congratulate all of you. I know you're ahead of the game. In terms of, we've gotten a lot of questions about testing and tracing for COVID, no one expects your school to engage in testing itself. I would continue to encourage you to reach out to your local departments of health. I know that sometimes it could be hard to get in touch with them, but you should continue to endeavor to work with your districts, particularly in New York City, and those local DOHs to develop those plans to respond to the governor's requirement. Renewal applications for Board of Regents authorized schools are due on the 14th, which is this Friday. And we also look forward to looking through those 15 renewal applications for the 2021 school year. As Yomika mentioned, ESSER applications, I think it is worth saying one more time, because we do not want any charter schools not to submit an ESSER application, but they are due by Saturday, which is August 15th. And if you do have any questions about the ESSER application or the combined application, don't contact me, don't contact my office, rather, you can email caresact@nyse.gov. That's caresact@nyse.gov. They are the experts on this, and they will be more than happy to help you. Lastly, even though we're all enmeshed in reopening and our reopening plans, the business of the legislature continues. And actually, I personally was very glad to see that both the Senate and Assembly passed Assembly Bill 5240, which requires that all single occupancy bathrooms across the state needs to be designated as gender neutral, and that school boards, including charter school boards, do need a policy about this. I think that continues to put New York as a leader in terms of equity for all students, whether they're low income, sexual minority, or whatnot. So, can you still hear me? Okay, good. Yeah, I saw someone in the chat said they couldn't hear me. So, that does apply to charter schools. It hasn't been signed by the governor yet, and we'll stay in touch with you about that. That being said, I will turn it back to you, Mika.
All right, great. Thank you, David, for that update. Lori, I'm going to reach out to you. Do you have an update for us today?
Hi, everyone. Yes, good afternoon. So similar to what David and Susie shared, we are going through your reopening plans. Thank you all for the thoughtfulness and the innovation that I see in those. It's really been awesome to start to see the different approaches that you all are taking based on your individual communities' needs and preferences. But just a quick heads up, I will be reaching out sometimes for quick clarifying questions, which some of you have gotten already, or I may be scheduling some time for longer conversations. That's my only update for right now.
All right, thank you, Lori. We're going to dive in now to the questions that we have received in advance. The first one is for you, David. Can you speak to the current status and your future expectations about SPED billing in the 2021 school year? In particular, students with IEPs are not in person.
Yes, so we are working very closely with districts across the state, particularly our colleagues in New York City, and the New York City DOE is eagerly looking for guidance from state ed. With the leadership transition, I feel like deja vu a little bit talking about a leadership transition at SED, but we're working through that, we hope to be able to release additional guidance in the coming weeks. However, we would encourage you to take a look at existing SED guidance. There's actually a plethora of SED Q&As regarding special education, and I can put that in the chat in a little bit. But there's a lot of information out there. Continue to work closely with your committees on special education. And the most important thing you can do is to continue to advocate and support your students with disabilities, even if you are providing remote instruction. And so some of the things that you can think about are actually enumerated in our spring remote monitoring and oversight guide that I'll also put a link in the chat in a second. But how are you providing equity and access for all students, even in a remote environment? How are you differentiating instruction? How are you working with related service providers if you're remote? Now that might mean that can they receive related services in person, even though your program is remote? Are there telepractice sessions that they can do? We really want you to think outside the box, use your autonomy, your innovation, and support the needs of your most vulnerable students.
Okay, thank you. Susie, Lori, I want to give you the opportunity to add any comments on the question or the answer. All right. Very good. So turning now to the next question, is there guidance on use of temperature scanners? There were some concerns that scanners could not be used because of privacy concerns related to facial recognition technology and the limits on those in New York State. Does anyone have an update or information on that?
I don't, and we can circle back around and answer or share out next week. I'm also missing the piece of the question, perhaps, which is the guns that take your temperature don't necessarily take your picture, but some might do both. Is that the nature?
There are some screens
where
you like walk by it. It's like, remember when the TSA thing first came out and you could see the whole body and then they made the lines? It's like that.
Well, we're going to have to circle back around to give any kind of good advice on that. Again, I might, I will channel Ralph Rossi a little bit. If your staff is concerned about such things, it's a question you should definitely ask your HR attorney.
Great advice. Thank you. Thank you. David, Lori, before I move to the next question, I just want to give you an opportunity to respond.
I would encourage you to keep it simple. I know that there's a lot of concern about people waiting down the block, students to get into your building to do a remote, to do the temperature scan. I've seen a lot of temperature scans happen in person, people getting on buses, entering schools. And if you're scanning 500 students, it's not instantaneous, but it's probably not as long as people say it is. It can happen, especially if you have a team, someone taking a temperature, someone recording it, and you have multiple people doing it. It can happen relatively quickly. But that being said, I would encourage you to work with your legal counsel to ensure that you're in compliance with all applicable laws, including Education Law 2D, which relates to student privacy.
Thank you for that. Before we move on to the Q&A, I just want to circle back for a second and just touch on the question again of contract tracing. Schools are scrambling to understand sort of what's required. David, you touched on that a little bit. I want to open it up to everyone and offer you, David, the opportunity to say more to clarify what schools should take into consideration in terms of contact tracing plans.
So the governor in his, thanks Yamika, the governor in his remarks mentioned that schools, and I presume including charter schools, although I think we're waiting on a little more guidance regarding that, but need a plan to engage in contact tracing should students test positive or suspect that they're positive. I don't believe that it was intended that all schools would engage in contact tracing themselves. Rather, that schools would just develop a plan. What will happen regarding contact tracing should a student test positive? New York State has a lot of information on contact tracing. I think that the, and I'll share a link. I love sharing links, but there's another link in the chat. I would strongly encourage you to work with your Department of Health in order to facilitate contact tracing should you need it. If you can't get in touch with your Department of Health, which I know is a source of frustration for many schools, not just charter schools, by the way, but schools across the state, you might want to reach out to the New York State Department of Health or some of the that are in the link that I just sent. I know that, for example, Johns Hopkins has a contact tracing program. CUNY has a contact tracing program that you might want to talk to them about. But if I were a school developing a plan, I would rely on my local Department of Health.
And then I'll just add that that I think that a big part of this is clarifying and being clear in your plan about how you will support the tracing. And I think this is through, I think this is through information. I think this is the time that your record keeping needs to be on point. So student and staff attendance, cohort composition, cohort schedules, cleaning, family updated family contact information, detailed visitor logs. So just thinking through if a tracer is calling your school to help get information, making sure that you have all of that information ready to assist if a tracer reaches out for more information from your school.
All right, good, great advice. So with that, that's the last of the questions. Anne, I'm gonna hand it off to you for questions in the Q&A.
Great, and I just, you know, we got a lot of these questions in advance and did a lot of legwork and clarifying, and I just really wanna underscore what Lori said, which is that the governor's requirement which are not new, but he was hearing, I think, a lot of the specific concerns that you all were hearing and realizing that district plans in particular were 50, 60, 70 pages long. That was not making anyone feel better, right? And so what he wants is for a family or a staff member to both be engaged, but also if they need to find specific components of your plan very quickly and easily, they're right there on your website. It doesn't mean that you need to go out and create from whole cloth a testing or a contact tracing program, so much as to say exactly what Lori said. And I don't know if any of you have actually had the joy of being contacted by the contact tracing program. Yeah. And it's pretty automated. And that is actually triggered by a positive test. So it is not triggered by, you know, a school calling DOH, right? And so it is much more the expectation, exactly what Lori said, that if a contact tracer contacts your school, that you're able to say, these are the kids who are in that pod. This is the teacher who saw them that day. These are the rooms that they were in. And then for you to be able to be transparent to families about then what happens. Right? You find out that you've had a positive test. What are you shutting down? For how long? Who are you notifying? How are you notifying them? Not necessarily that you have to bring testing on site or have some dedicated testing relationship where, you know, people, you're specifically sending people and they're expecting to be seen because they're a member of your school. So I wanted to put a box around that because I think we got a lot of those questions. And I have to admit some of them, even for me, pushed me to clarify my understanding of what the state contact tracing infrastructure is. And so it is not that schools need to be going out and doing this themselves so much as that they are equipped to participate when called upon. David, Lori. Susie?
Yes, thank you.
Okay, great. And I say that in part because there were a couple questions in the Q&A that I think I can check the box on. All right, so David, the the ESSER application, can that be signed electronically, or does it have to be signed physically? Do you know?
That is a great question for CARES Act at NYCD.gov. That's CARES Act at
NYCD.gov. How about this? Let's save our CARES Act email friends from the 278 emails they might get following this. We will follow up with them, and we will include what we find in a subsequent follow-up email.
Sounds good. I'm trying very hard to delegate.
Excellent.
Well, it's skill for you leaders out there.
We'll try hard so that they don't hate charters right off the bat. So then Ellen asked a question, and David, I think this is another one for you. I know that in the July Board of Regents meeting, there was a lot of discussion around flexibility for documentation regarding physicals and immunizations. I can't say off the top of my head what that flexibility is, but I know that it was intended. Is that something that you can speak to, or a piece of the guidance that you would point people to?
So that's, if you will, that's something I have to look into further.
Wait, and Francisco, I think we have a mic drop. Is anyone else like in live news world? Kamala Harris, Biden's VP? All right. Thank you, Francisco, for that breaking news report. I'm sorry, David. So you're saying you'll follow up.
Wait, hold on. Kamala Harris trumps me. But that's sorry, okay. Brian. She can trump me.
If she can trump Trump, then we'll.
Oh, yeah. Oh, there
we
you
are
go.
A nonpartisan organization, friends.
Can you repeat the question?
Yeah, so flexibility around submitting immunizations and physicals. And I know that the regents intended it. What I'm not clear about is if it has been promulgated to a degree of specificity.
So if you can follow up with an email, usually you're very good at following up with these questions. I will make sure that we get it to the right people at SED.
Great. I'm just making myself a note. But Ellen, my understanding is that it is intended. If it has not specifically been outlined, it was very clear in a couple of previous regents meetings that it was coming. All right. So this is similar to the question that was asked about requiring COVID testing for students. And we asked this question also of an HR lawyer on a webinar a couple weeks ago, but for the sake of today's conversation, can schools require staff to be COVID tested and presumably submit a negative test prior to school resuming? I can share that the guidance that the lawyer that we hosted in the webinar advised against it because of the complexity and, Susie, some of the things that you were alluding to around students. But do you all as authorizers have guidance or a perspective for schools on that?
Not being a lawyer. I will share with you what my lawyers tell us, which is that's really a question for your own HR lawyer. You all have your own sets, the great joy of the autonomy of being a charter school until there is a once in a century pandemic. You all have different personnel policies. You all have different structures, different roles and responsibilities. David's organization, my organization, Yomika and Anna's and Lori's organization all have those different things as well. And those all come into the analysis. So it really is a case for your HR lawyer to help you navigate what your other policies are for your staff.
Yeah, Susie, you couldn't have said it any better. I agree.
Great. A couple more before we hand it over to New York City specific or New York City questions. And so Yvonne Jones asked the question, and I have to admit, I am not familiar with what she's referencing. How does the home district COVID testing requirement apply to charters? Is anyone familiar with the home district, or are some home districts requiring COVID testing that folks are aware of? In theory, if that exists, does it apply to charters? And Yvonne, maybe you can follow up with us offline if you're in a district where a district is having that requirement.
Well, I would just say blanketly that the district requirements are not applicable to charter schools. State requirements that are applicable to health are applicable to charter schools as they are other public schools. But if your district has a requirement for their staff or their general education students, that would not be applicable to charter schools. Unless otherwise prescribed by law.
It's an excellent asterisk to all things. Susie, Lori, anything to add?
No.
So, all right. So then last question, because this came up in both the chat and the Q&A. Any updates or expectations around the governor needing to waive the 180-day requirement in the expectation that some schools will not be in person in September? And we know, for example, that the Buffalo District has already submitted that application because they have been speculating that they will not return in person or at all potentially until October, just as a quick example.
Yeah, and lots of charter schools aren't returning until later in the year in person as well. The Board of Regents at their July meeting already allowed for flexibilities to the 180-day calendar. So, we'll see what the governor does, but the Board of Regents has already taken action on this. And we've discussed that at other meetings. So in terms of funding and per pupil billing, you would continue to bill for students that you're educating. And that's why your reopening plan and your attendance policies are so important. You need to follow those documents.
All right. With that, I will hand it over to Corey and Anjali.
Good afternoon, everyone. I think I'm here with Anjali, but I might actually be here with Erin. I'm not sure. Is it Anjali?
Hi, Corey.
Yes, it is. Okay. Not that I would have been excited to see Erin too. but wanted to get started. I think just a couple of quick announcements. I think that, you know, we have a lot of questions about the New York City, the contract tracing program, as people have submitted to us, as they put in the chat. This is definitely something we're very focused on. The center, we've been working with DOE and DOH. We are hosting another series this Friday. The invite just went out a few minutes ago, 1 p.m. So please come. I'll let Anjali add anything she wants to add about that. But I do think that a lot of these questions, I think as someone put it in the chat, like, this is not your responsibility as a charter school to come up with a track and trace program at all. There is a program in place in New York City. You are going to be a full partner in that program. Every charter school will be a part of it. It is going to end up being DOH contacting your school. I think that's something that we have a couple questions I'll ask as a follow-up in a minute. But definitely please attend on Friday. Watch for any documents. I know people are putting in the chat, the documents are being worked on. We expect them to be released. Some are already up on DOE's website, which we linked in the document that we sent out to you guys all this afternoon. So please stay tuned. I know this is an issue of great concern, but we're, you know, getting you the information as quickly as possible. And that will definitely be part of the call on Friday. Anjali, is there anything you want to add about Friday?
No, you covered it, Corey. Thank you.
And I would just add, I know that a lot of you have been submitting questions. If you could please do so by 5 p.m. tomorrow in the link in the invite as well, just so we have all the questions. We're also going to be going through some of the facility-related questions that I know folks are having. So that's the first announcement. Second thing we wanted to talk about, and Anjali, I'll let you do the honors, but one of the questions of the last few weeks we've heard lots and lots of times is, will New York City charter schools have access to the 34 testing sites that DOE teachers will have access to for expedited testing?
Yeah, so the answer to that, Corey, is yes. So we, charter school teachers, will have access. We're currently figuring out what method of confirmation or verification will be accepted, because district teachers are bringing their IDs, and we have been talking to a few schools and understand that most charter schools don't give IDs to their teachers. So we're working on a workaround. So this may be like a letter or something that comes from our office. More to come on that.
Got it. So again, some good news out of DOE, DOH. So hopefully, again, this will help schools as you are getting ready for reopening. Yeah. I also wanted to take a moment, Anjali. I know right before this call, Charter Weekly, you sent out an addendum. And there were a couple things that I already saw folks asking about in the chat. So I wondered if you could just touch on them briefly. Let's start with the first one, is that DOE is now asking for a first day of in-person instruction from all the charters in New York City.
That's correct. Yep.
Okay. And this is to support the MetroCard ask?
Yeah. So we have, we are planning for MetroCard distribution for this school year, and we need to know how to plan deliveries for this. We understand that this is, you know, this date may change, but for now, for planning purposes, we do need that information. And Erin, please chime in. I know that there are other projects that we're working on that we need this information for.
Yeah, it's definitely primarily most immediately for fall MetroCard, but there are a bunch of other things that we're also needing that information for as well. And I just want to add that this does not replace early MetroCard requests or nursing requests or anything else that you may already have in the works. This is just a request for your first day of school, of in-person school.
And then the other announcements was regarding the enhanced cleaning protocols for school reopening. It seems like DOE has created a document that all charters would be able to access in terms of what the custodians, and this obviously would be most relevant to co-located schools, on how the cleaning process will work in those schools. Is that right?
That's correct, Corey. And one thing I didn't mention when you announced the session for Friday at 1, is that our colleague, John Shea, he's the chief executive for the division that oversees custodians. He's gonna be joining us for part of that, for part of that call, to go through any questions that come in around those procedures.
Got it. So again, folks that got the invite from the Charter Center, if you didn't, please make sure you reach out to us so we can get, make sure you get it. Please use the link embedded in that invite to put in those questions, particularly if you have custodial questions, which would only come out if you read the guidance that was released about a half an hour ago. So we will expect your questions, and you can always reach out to me directly if you have any concerns. Moving on, we did get, I know we're going to cover more of this, Anjali, on Friday, but just since everyone, a lot of folks are here, as part of the New York City Test and Trace program, are charters going to have an assigned liaison, or is it going to switch around depending on who actually is working on a particular case?
Great question. So there's not going to be an assigned liaison. There's going to be a team at DOHMH that will conduct all the investigations and help schools identify close contacts in need of quarantine, and sort of advise schools on next steps. We have, you know, right now I know everybody's eager to talk to DOHMH directly. We're going to continue to host them with you, Corey, on Fridays. We're hoping for a weekly basis. But for now, they are asking that charter schools in New York City liaise with our office until they have their school support team set up. And at that time, if there's ever, you know, if there's a positive case in your school, the team will contact you directly. And we are sharing contacts with DOH so that they know who the principals are in your school, director of operations, et cetera. And if there's a positive case that for some reason they don't know about, then you can contact them and inform them of the case. I'm going to give you a number, Corey. I'm going to say it out loud and then I'll put it in the chat. The number is 866-692-3641. And this is the number that DOH has asked us to provide to schools if they have a confirmed positive case. Not if you hear that someone was positive, if you have some documentation of a confirmed case. That was a very long answer, Corey, but let me know if I covered your question.
I think you did. And we will make sure we get that number out there. So folks who pick it up in the chat, great. But if not, that will be a number that we will all know and make sure to publicize for all of you in New York City.
If I could just say one thing about contact tracing. One thing is we already have had some state agencies reach out wanting to get in touch with charter schools. And so I know it's not the most exciting thing in the world, but keep your SEDREF information up to date. And that way we can get the information for your school out as quickly as possible. Just putting a plug for that.
I'm going to piggyback on that, David. So Erin, I know that we're sending out, instructions on how to update CHIP, which is where we manage our contact information. It's very, very important that we have the most updated information because we're constantly being asked for school contacts and principals, et cetera. So look out for that email and make sure that we have the latest.
Okay, I will continue on unless I'm cutting you off, Erin. Please interrupt me, sorry if I am. So moving on, we're always gonna get this question on Julie. I know you would know it no matter what, but any updates on the DOE calendar?
No update, Corey.
Okay. I think also I'm seeing in the chat questions about in-person related services. I know that one of the documents that went out last week, I believe, was on related services. I think you answered some of the questions to say you're going to bring them up to the special ed office hours this Thursday, but anything else that you can provide right now about that? And folks, if you're looking for a link to that, I will ask that Erin or Anjali maybe put a link to the related services document.
I don't have anything to add right now, Corey. We are working on a policy for charter schools around that question. I know that some schools are interested in offering only teletherapy for their students. And so that is in discussions right now. I'm adding the link to register for the special ed office hours in the chat. So please make sure that you join us and we'll go from there.
Got it. Also, a question we always need to check in about is any updates on busing? And I would say not only busing, but in the absence of busing, will there be MetroCards provided to families beyond just the student if families need to help assist get their students to school?
So no updates on busing. I do have an update on MetroCards, or not an update. We sent a request for schools to T their students. Erin, can you fill the gap there? Remind me what the deadline?
Sure. So we are asking that schools go into TLST and indicate transportation need by the end of this week. And that will support the preparation of MetroCard shipments. And we know that many schools have received new OPT codes, so it's very, very important that you make sure that you are assigning students to the correct class code that is aligned to the correct OPT code, because that is what determines eligibility and to ensure that they're getting service at the right location. And we'll be sharing more about the timeline for fall MetroCards, I think, in the next few weeks.
Thank you, Erin.
No problem.
And then last topic, schools are, particularly schools who are starting in August, are interested if there's any updates in person, I should say. A lot of schools are starting in August virtually. But if you're starting in person in August, what should schools be doing about ensuring that there is a school nurse available?
For Corey, we're getting ready to send an email to schools with some next steps on nursing. I think right now, if you are a charter in a private space that's planning to open in person in August, then I recommend that you reach out to your borough nursing director. And of course, let us know, fill out the survey that we sent out right away so that we're aware of that information.
Okay. Also, I think we last kind of one announcement I think also we saw was the building response team training has gone out, or your new guidance on it. Can you talk a little bit about that and what schools could expect, particularly especially those in the co-located space, about being a member of the building response team this year and how that might look different?
Yeah, absolutely. So we are, so just a quick refresher. So the building response team is a school-based team that's required per building. And this team is activated to manage health and safety incidents or emergencies in schools. This year, there will be more responsibilities and additional members that are required to be on the BRT. And we're working, we're working to send out, we're working to get the details of the training, hoping to have that by Thursday so that charters can join to go through the new responsibilities, the new members that will be part of that. And there will be specific COVID-19 related responsibilities that will also be covered in that training.
Got it. And just to be clear, this is only for schools who are in co-located space that have to be part of these teams. Obviously, charters in private space can make their own teams. Their own teams might have different names, but this is something that all co-located charters will need to pay attention to in the C-Weekly or whenever the announcement goes out.
That's right.
Yeah. I see a question on ATS that I'm hoping you or maybe Erin can answer, which is, list notice students won't show up in ATS until 9:10. How can we see them, I think?
Why don't you, whoever's posted this question, please email us directly. You should be able to see your students right now.
All right. And then I think the last question, which I probably know the answer already, but I will put it out there because we get a lot of questions about this every week. Any more details on the daycare seats that the city has pledged to make available? I think it's
100,000.
That's right, 100,000 seats. Yeah. Any updates on availability for charter schools or charter school students, I should say?
Definitely. So I don't have all of the details on this, Corey, but I do know that we're hoping that this is available across the board, similar to how we had the recs. But again, I don't have final confirmation on this. We're working to firm that up in the next few weeks.
Got it. I think that's all the questions I have, and I think you guys have either answered them in the chat or we have done them here. So anything else, Anjali or Erin, that you want to add? I know there is a lot of information coming out at schools. I did put into the chat, and I will repaste it again. Anjali has put in the special education office hours, and I will put in the invite again from the Charter Center for the Friday 1 p.m. webinar, just so everyone can see it.
Yeah. Corey, one more reminder. So I am putting the link for the Google form. This is the form where you can submit your questions about the documents and policies that we've released over the last few weeks, and of course any question that you have around the reopening. We're using the survey to help inform how we're gonna structure the next set of office hours and calls with the different program offices across the DOE. So it'd be super helpful if you can submit your questions there. Of course, for the session that's happening this Friday, we ask that you submit your questions by the end of the day tomorrow, but please continue to use that survey on an ongoing basis. That's all I have. Erin, anything to add?
No, nothing to add.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Corey.
Great. Thanks, Anjali. Thanks, Erin. And with that, I will turn it over to Yumika.
All right, great. Thank you. Thank you, everyone. That's the end of our webinar. I do want to point out that I just dropped in the chat the information on local health departments. You should see that. So that if you're working on your contact tracing plans or needed information, please note that the contacts for all county local county health departments is at that link. Be well. Remember, Thursday we will see you again for the Credo webinar with the authorizers. Until then, be safe. Any questions, email us, call us. Take care. Bye-bye.